Oui, solno 28-4, paracétamol.
Solno
28-4. Thérèse, elle a tout fait. Rose.
March 2014. When patients and health workers died in Gekedu in the Guinea forest region, this was the first warning sign. MSF teams made an on-site visit, and some days later, laboratory tests identified the culprit. It was the Ebola virus, which spread rapidly through the country and then to Sierra Leone and neighboring Liberia. This was only the beginning of a nightmarish year, during which MSF found itself facing unprecedented challenges.
MSF is not able longer to cope with everything here. Normally in Ebola, we try to be a step before the Ebola is coming to the villages, but we are completely too late. Last week, we came to a village where we had around 40 patients from one village. It's unbelievable. I never have seen it before.
At the peak of the epidemic, MSF was running 15 Ebola treatment centers, and exposing its teams to very high levels of risk of contamination. And for many months, the organization made vain attempts to call on the international community for help.
Six months into the worst Ebola epidemic in history, the world is losing the battle to contain it. Médecins Sans Frontières has been ringing alarm bells for months, but the response has been too late, too little. Many of the member states represented here today have invested heavily in biological threat response. You have a political and humanitarian responsibility to immediately utilize these capabilities in Ebola-affected countries.
At the beginning, MSF's French section contributed to combating the epidemic by deploying personnel to help the other MSF sections, who are working directly in the field and providing most of the response to Ebola. Its only treatment center in Konkon in Guinea opened too late to treat patients. In the autumn, seeing that Liberia's entire health system had been thrown into chaos by the epidemic, the teams decided to assist with non-Ebola activities. These included distributions of anti-malaria drugs, supporting 28 health centers, and refurbishing and training staff at one of Monrovia's public hospitals.
Since the Ebola outbreak, patients got afraid to come to the hospital, staff got afraid as well, so the hospital was relatively closed for a while. Yeah, most people, like I said, were all afraid of, you know, getting infected with Ebola. The patients were not telling us whether they came in contact with Ebola people and all that. So because of that, most of them end up staying at home, treating themselves. Some people die as a result of the hospital being closed.
But helping facilities to reopen wasn't enough. More hospital beds were needed. So in March, a 50-bed pediatric hospital was opened. 10 of the beds are for emergency cases. In the same building, there is a clinic delivering medical care and psychosocial support to Ebola survivors who are suffering from the after effects of the disease and are frequently stigmatized.
Sometimes I can feel so bad when I lost all my family people. Yes. Sometimes I can have a bad dream. Sometimes I don't sleep because when I'm thinking, I will not be able to sleep. I can't sleep.
At the beginning of May, Liberia declared the epidemic officially over, but it continues to spread in Guinea and Sierra Leone. More than 1 year after the first case appeared, almost 27,000 people have contracted the disease and 11,000 have died. The epidemic led to an unprecedented research effort, which MSF contributed to by participating in trials on three treatments and a vaccine in Guinea and Liberia. These tools and fast, reliable diagnostic tests are crucial to prevent another catastrophe of such huge proportions.
Since March 2015, forces loyal to President in office Hadi have been fighting those backing the former president and who have formed an alliance with the Houthi rebels. The conflict quickly escalated, notably around the international airport in Aden, the largest town in the south of the country. At the end of March, the urban warfare was compounded by bombing from the sea and air. MSF is working in Aden. The hostilities have been extremely violent and have caused casualties on both sides, but civilians are the worst affected. Aden Hospital was quickly submerged by the arrival of so many wounded people. Most are young men, but there are women and children too. The majority have bullet or shrapnel wounds.
They are dirty wounds. If they come late, the wound will get dirty and then we have difficulty. And of course, because the injury are caused by the bomb or the gunshot, so sometimes we see very bad fractures.
Yes. What happened?
Alan.
Oh, dear.
The teams have been working around the clock, 7 days a week, and have treated over 1,000 casualties. But outside, the security situation is worsening. Attacks, snipers, and skirmishes are increasingly common, making it very dangerous to move around.
Each morning, if I can give you an example, it is a challenge for our team at the hospital. We never know who will be able, among our staff, the nurses, the doctors, who will be able to come to our hospital because of the fights, because of the roads. Some of our staff, they are sleeping since 2 weeks in our hospital because it's impossible to move.
I think the MSF alone work now. In this moment, the MSF, I just... is alone.
Main access roads blocked, ambulances attacked. MSF has called on the various warring parties several times to respect the neutrality of aid workers.
Security films prevent shattered glass from flying everywhere. Last month there was an explosion nearby and five large windows broke. Without the film, anyone standing near the window would have been injured.
Meanwhile, not far from the capital in the north of the country, the hospital in Khamir treats patients from all over the region. This town too has been brought to a standstill by shortages and insecurity.
There's no fuel, no transportation. It's difficult for them to come to the hospital. When they come at all, the cases are very critical. Before the war, we used to refer them to Sana for a bigger hospital. Sometimes we take them doing not enough work for them, just a palliative care to see symptomatic treatment.
By the end of March, the teams in Aden saw their stocks of drugs and medical supplies dwindling to dangerously low levels.
We knew that in 2 weeks, or one, or even the next day, we'd have nothing left. It was particularly stressful, as we had nothing to relieve our patients' pain. It was a huge issue, especially for the anaesthetists. When we found out that a cargo was on its way, we were so relieved. It was wonderful to get such great news.
On the 8th of April, MSF finally managed to bring in emergency medical supplies, shipped to Aden and flown to Sana'a. Sana'a Airport has been bombed several times. This makes it difficult to deliver medical supplies to MSF's programs and constantly jeopardizes the work of our teams.
As the international forces gradually pull out from Kar, the situation in the country remains extremely tense. The past 12 months have seen continuous violence and insecurity. On 5th December 2013, the anti-Balaka offensive against Seleka rebels in the capital Bangui was accompanied by reprisals of an extreme violence against the Muslim population. Associated in spite of themselves with the Selekas, many were forced to flee for their lives. Up to 90% of Muslims in Western Kar have had to leave their country. Those who managed to find refuge in Chad were subjected before or during their flight to exceptional levels of violence that left 2,600 people dead.
Despite being escorted by the Chadian army, people said they had been subject to attacks, sometimes very violent attacks, rape and armed attacks, during their journey by truck, mainly to Chad.
The Muslims who remain have no freedom of movement and are confined to enclaves under international protection. Like here in Kano, where 500 people still live in the church. They have no real hope of ever returning home, and any attempt to leave the compound could cost them their lives.
If peace returns, we can go home, but there's nothing left. Our homes are destroyed. Everything's been smashed or stolen.
In Bangui, there's another Muslim enclave in PK5 district. They have shut themselves away, but remain vulnerable and live in a state of extreme anxiety. MSF teams have set up stationary and mobile medical services in these enclaves. The main pathologies are diarrhea, respiratory infections, and of course malaria, the primary medical emergency. Over 153,000 consultations provided in 2014 were related to this disease. With the country's health system at a standstill and extremely poor levels of vaccination coverage, preventable diseases are starting to appear. Measles broke out at the beginning of 2015 in the east, notably in Bria. To reduce the risk of an epidemic, in early March, MSF teams launched a vaccination campaign.
Our campaign here in Bria is targeting 15,000 children. At the same time as we immunize against measles, we screen for malnutrition. Children who are found to be sick are referred to the hospital.
To further extend this vaccination coverage, MSF teams are preparing another mass immunization campaign for June. France has already initiated a partial withdrawal of its Operation Sangaris force. But the humanitarian and security crisis remains only too obvious. The economy and schools no longer function. Healthcare provision has all but collapsed, and people are traumatized. Stepping in for the state, inadequate at the best of times, aid organizations are struggling to address the country's numerous health and humanitarian needs.
Allahu Akbar! At-tayran al-harbi! Allahu Akbar!
It's no longer possible to work in Syria in areas controlled by the Islamic State group. After last year's abduction of MSF personnel by members of armed groups, the organization no longer had the guarantees required to ensure the security of its teams. So in August 2014, MSF decided to pull out its international staff and cut back its operations, which are now run from Turkey.
It's particularly frustrating, I think, for us now, because we no longer have international staff inside Syria. So it's the impression that I get is all secondhand information from our national staff working inside. And what they're telling me and what they told me during the last few months was that it's a real disaster inside. Allahu
Akbar. Due to the absence of guarantees regarding its team's security, MSF had to close several facilities, including a hospital under Islamic State control in Aleppo Governorate. But needs here are huge.
After almost 4 years of war, the fighting continues and the situation in Syria is getting worse. Government forces continue to target health facilities. The health system has completely collapsed and people suffering from chronic diseases are being denied regular access to treatment.
The conflict has led to large numbers of people with burn injuries. Children and adults with severe burns arrive every day at the MSF hospital, which is still open in Idlib province. It's the only center in North Syria providing this kind of specialist treatment. Between May 2014 and April 2015, the teams admitted close to 1,700 burn victims to the emergency room.
We provide burn patients with adapted surgical treatment, skin grafts, for example, and physiotherapy. Because burns can lead to contracture, it's crucial to mobilize the limbs.
The burns are caused by explosions and domestic accidents, as people here cook and keep themselves warm with poor quality fuel.
In one camp, there was a fire that then set fire to a whole group of tents. It happened early in the morning, and there were children sleeping in those tents. It's not their fault. People are getting burned because they're trying to keep warm or because of barrel bombs exploding.
Beyond the camp, the violence continues, causing more and more Syrians to flee. Since the conflict began 4 years ago, half of Syria's population have had to leave their homes. Those who haven't left the country are in camps near the border, like this one in the north.
There are 300 families here. We were given 60 tents during a first distribution, then a further 30, so 90 in all. People sold their furniture and whatever belongings they brought with them to buy a tent or build some form of shelter.
Living conditions for these families are difficult, particularly during the winter months when it's cold and it snows. To mitigate the disastrous consequences of the collapse of the health system, MSF has carried out several vaccination campaigns. However, needs in general are enormous. People are desperate for more assistance, but much to MSF's regret, delivering aid is proving difficult due to the lack of security.
At the end of April 2014, Israeli-Palestinian peace talks were suspended. And at the beginning of July, Israel launched a major military offensive on the Gaza Strip, its third in 6 years. The official aim of Operation Protective Edge was to put an end to Hamas rocket fire and destroy tunnels that supposedly gave protection to combatants. But in reality, it was civilians who, unable to escape from this 41-kilometer-long strip of land, were to pay the heaviest price. 25 medical facilities were damaged, over 10,000 people wounded, and more than 2,000 killed in less than 2 months. Medical staff at the Al-Shifa hospital were swamped, and 10 days into the offensive, an MSF team was deployed to provide them with support.
We haven't seen such levels of shelling and destruction before, and the medical teams were extremely concerned about the numbers of victims they'd find in the streets, about keeping the operating room running round the clock and so on. MSF teams were working through the night to relieve the Ministry of Health staff who were exhausted, but who had continued working, doing an amazing job.
People with multiple injuries, burns, shrapnel wounds. Trauma cases poured into Nasser Hospital in Khan Yunis in the South Gaza too. The casualties, mainly women and children, would arrive in waves, while the Palestinian surgical teams performed procedure after procedure as fast as they could. Many patients were also provided with post-operative and nursing care and physiotherapy at MSF's Gaza clinic. It was only after 50 days of conflict and shelling that an indefinite ceasefire was finally concluded.
So we're planning the next stage. We have specialized staff and are going to suggest to the Ministry of Health that we focus on reconstructive surgery, particularly for blast victims with burns, of which there are many, to continue working in the intensive care unit and to reinforce post-operative care.
Two days after the beginning of the truce, the 520,000 displaced people started to return home. Most of them found nothing but rubble.
After this war, I don't think there is a hope. What hope after all these destructions and after the old buildings that was destroyed? I think Gaza needs more, as they say, 20 years to rebuild and to re-set up all the structures in Gaza. Everything is destroyed in Gaza.
As the military offensive continued in Gaza, the West Bank was the scene of clashes of an extreme violence. Following the abduction of three young Israeli settlers in June, Israel made hundreds of military incursions and many arrests. Along the streets of the old city of Hebron, families hide behind closed shutters. Intimidated and aggressed, their homes are demolished by Israeli soldiers. Like many Palestinians, Zainab watched, powerless, as her home was destroyed.
At 3 in the afternoon, 14 military jeeps filled with soldiers arrived and 2 bulldozers. First, they demolished the houses up there, and then they came to us and asked us to evacuate. But we didn't evacuate as fast and easily as they wanted, so they did it by force.
Given this renewed tension, MSF has increased its mental health care programs in the West Bank, Hebron, Nablus, and East Jerusalem to provide support to hundreds of new patients, including children in a state of shock and people suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. But they're going to need more than just emergency treatment. It will take years for them to get over the trauma of a conflict that is so far from being resolved.
In 2014, almost 200,000 people fled from war-torn South Sudan to West Ethiopia and finished their journeys in the Gambella region. Starved of food and clean water, the refugees arrive in very poor health.
The majority of the arrivals are mainly women and children. I think it accounts for about 90% of the number. These people, due to the long distances they have to walk, they arrive basically in a fatigue state and very tired.
Nujun Ross left South Sudan with her 3 children after her husband died. It took them 2 weeks to walk to Gambella.
We survived on the fruit we picked off trees and grass that we cooked. We were very hungry and thirsty. My son has already been ill, and I brought him to the hospital. But now he's sick again because of our shelter, our living conditions.
Okay. No vomiting, no diarrhea. This child was admitted yesterday. He's about 4 months old. He presented with cough and fever. We started the treatment for lower respiratory tract infection, and he needs oxygen. He's breastfeeding, but so it's going slowly. It's only since yesterday. We will see how it goes.
Exhaustion, malnutrition, and poor sanitation all contribute to the spread of infectious diseases in the region's camps. And that's not counting the torrential rain that regularly floods the camps and worsens still further the refugees' living conditions. MSF is working in 3 camps near the border, notably in Lechor camp, where teams have set up a 100-bed hospital with an emergency room and malnutrition treatment. 20 to 40 pregnant women go to the maternity unit every week.
A lot of them have faced a lot of trauma. A lot of them have seen their family members die in front of them. Once they're here, the conditions are very hard. It's insecure for women. Sometimes their husbands aren't here. So to live here when they're in a life of insecurity is very, very hard.
So you finished 2 boxes, huh? I give you 2 more.
During the summer of 2014, MSF carried out a cholera vaccination campaign to prevent a possible outbreak of the disease. Some of the refugees may have been carriers of the cholera bacteria, as there had been an epidemic back in South Sudan for several months. 155,000 people over the age of 1 year in the camps and surrounding villages have been vaccinated.
If there happened to be any case of cholera, it's going to be an explosion, which is going to be very, very difficult to manage because the site is not really is waterlogged. To maintain hygiene, it is not so easy for anyone at all.
Such poor living conditions, aggravated by the rainy season, increase the risk of respiratory infections. So in November, MSF launched another multiple vaccination campaign to prevent pneumonia and reduce infant mortality. Around 76,000 vaccine doses were administered to South Sudanese children.
The situation in northeast Nigeria has progressively deteriorated over the past 4 years. Villagers fleeing from fighting and attacks have had to abandon their homes. The majority of them have sought refuge in Borno State, where there are now 500,000 displaced people. Most of the displaced persons camps are in state capital Maiduguri, but Islamist group Boko Haram still has the town in its sights and attacked it several times in 2014 and 15. With the economy at a standstill and the provision of healthcare virtually non-existent, needs are enormous. MSF has been working in Maiduguri since 2014. The teams have set up stationary and mobile clinics in the town's most densely populated camps and handle the transfer of emergency cases to hospitals. As well as respiratory infections, malaria is a constant threat.
Yeah, actually, malaria in Maiduguri, you can imagine how all the camps have been set up. Of course, most of the camps are schools and buildings which are not really completed, like, for example, 80% in completion. Most of the windows are not there, so definitely there is no mosquito netting in the building, and also there are a lot of stagnant water around. So definitely you can imagine you have a lot of mosquitoes, and that can cause the malaria.
In such poor sanitary conditions, malaria epidemics are not the only risk. Between September and December 2014, MSF responded to a cholera outbreak in several of Maiduguri's camps. Around 7,000 people received treatment, almost 40% of whom were from the camps for the displaced.
In addition to that, we set up a surveillance system to investigate outbreaks, to detect them as early as possible and to respond to them.
Fighting between Boko Haram and the Nigerian army resumed at the end of March 2015, and over 6,000 people have swelled the numbers of displaced in Maiduguri. The health issues this time are compounded by food shortages.
That most of the IDPs are farmers in their original villages before the displacement. They couldn't cultivate, they couldn't plant, and we anticipate a major nutrition crisis in Borno State.
The influx of displaced people will continue as long as the fighting and attacks continue. MSF teams will endeavor to provide a response, adaptive to new needs as they arise.
Several ceasefires have been concluded in East Ukraine since the conflict began a year ago. But the truce is fragile. The fighting has already claimed over 6,000 lives and led to the displacement of more than 1.5 million people. In the aftermath of Russia's annexation of Crimea, pro-Russian separatist movements sprang up in the Donetsk and Luhansk regions. Clashes between rebel groups and the Ukrainian army during the summer of 2014 were of a rare intensity. Then last February, heavy fighting broke out around Debaltseve. 3 days after the beginning of the truce, the rebels gained control of this town, situated between Donetsk and Luhansk, that is considered strategic. Two of the town's hospitals were badly damaged. During the fighting, 5,000 of its inhabitants were forced to hole up in cellars or underground shelters. MSF began by providing consultations to people unable to leave their homes.
So we find that many patients are just suffering from primary care disorders and chronic diseases. Due to the population, the elderly population, there's a lot of hypertension, diabetes. And during the period of fighting, with the added stress, they've suffered complications such as stroke, heart attack, chronic heart failure. So the main diseases we see are hypertension and diabetes, as well as primary healthcare conditions such as respiratory tract infections. There's very little in terms of war trauma at the moment, as the fighting, the conflict has died down a little.
MSF has also equipped a minibus to go to different neighbourhoods in Debaltseve and provide medical consultations to patients no longer covered by the local health service.
There's people living in rural communities with very poor access to healthcare, to medical facilities. So we're now running mobile clinics inside small health posts out in the villages, and also within social institutions such as nursing homes, where again they just could not leave the home to access any form of healthcare.
Every day, the medical team treats some 60 patients in a setting that hasn't changed since the fighting stopped. There are few signs of any repairs in Debaltseve, where almost everything that was damaged still has to be rebuilt.
Just before midday on the 25th of April, a 7.8 magnitude earthquake hit the center of Nepal. Within minutes, over 130,000 homes collapsed and 85,000 others were damaged. By the end of May, the toll of the earthquake and its aftershocks was over 8,500 dead and 14,000 wounded. Victims were as much in densely populated cities such as Kathmandu and Pokhara as in remote rural areas. Several days after the quake, MSF deployed a reconnaissance team traveling by helicopter to locate the areas most in need, notably in Gorkha district, the epicenter.
Small mountain villages have been flattened and even larger towns are extremely difficult to get to. Some are accessible only by helicopter and it can take 7 hours to walk to others. The Ministry of Health and MSF decided it would be preferable to assist people who need our help in more remote locations rather than in the big towns.
MSF teams established their zone for intervention around the town of Arugat in Gorkha. A mountainous region, the inhabitants were in need of somewhere to take cover and essential items, so the teams began distributing shelters and blankets. The health center here was flattened. While awaiting the field hospital that needs to be assembled, the teams deal with the most urgent cases under this tarpaulin. Their resources are wholly inadequate.
This facility here is replacing the health center that was destroyed in the earthquake and which provides health care to the 10,000 inhabitants living here in Arugat, as well as the 40,000 people in the smaller, inaccessible villages in the surrounding health district. To give you an idea of the health care services available since the earthquake, this area here is where women give birth. A woman was here yesterday. It took her more than 3 hours to give birth, and she was surrounded by loads of people. It was rather strange, but all went well in the end. She had a little boy.
After many hours by road from Kathmandu, the inflatable hospital MSF sent over from Bordeaux arrived in Arugat. While the logistics team set it up, the surgical team provided support to Bakhtapur Hospital on the outskirts of the capital.
In this afternoon, we had 5 cases of surgery and some cases of soft tissue injuries, burns, and so the last case was so terrible because inside of the wound, there was so severe infection.
On the 8th of May, the team arrived in Arugat, and the hospital was finally ready to treat its first patients.
The idea is to work in collaboration with the Ministry of Health facility. They'll provide consultations and will admit patients with severe conditions.
Even though the hospital's catchment area is fairly vast, casualties directly related to the earthquake are not what MSF sees most.
The military evacuated lots of injured people by helicopter during the first few days. There aren't many casualties now, well, not in Arugat and the villages that the outreach program has visited. So we're going to quickly shift to more general hospital activities. Surgical services, of course, but also maternity care, and we'll probably have pediatric cases. We'll wait to see how it goes over the next few days and weeks before deciding.
In addition to their healthcare needs, thousands of people in remote mountain villages still don't have a roof over their heads. Planning ahead for the monsoon season, MSF teams are preparing to distribute essential items by helicopter.
July 2014. These children are refugees from South Sudan. They live in Lechuar camp in Ethiopia, and they're being vaccinated against cholera. It looks so quick and easy, but to get here necessitated setting up a flawless organization, which began over 700 kilometers away at Addis Ababa Airport.
The problem in the field and why we are transporting with this cold chain truck is the main reason is in the field, they couldn't manage to find a cold storage place. Which is a reliable plus which has a good backup. So we decide to put it here and to transport it to the field directly as like active cold chain.
This example is a good illustration of the obstacles to vaccinating during humanitarian emergencies. Natural disasters, population displacements, they all have their own specific requirements.
As new vaccines become available, we mustn't limit ourselves to just emergency immunization against measles. Once we've conducted a risk assessment in the targeted area, we need to integrate other vaccines. Immunization in an emergency situation is important not only to contain the risk of epidemics like measles and cholera, but also to reduce the burden of infectious diseases that can be prevented by vaccination. For example, whooping cough, a pneumococcus or haemophilus respiratory infection.
Most vaccines are administered as part of routine immunization for babies and children. But even here, issues with access to healthcare, the cost of vaccines, and the need to keep them cold right up to the time of administration pose challenges that result in 1 in 5 of the world's children being denied the immunization they so badly need.
On utilise de plus en plus de vaccins. Ces vaccins occupent des volumes en chaîne.
We're using more and more vaccines, and they take up a lot more room in the cold chain.
Donc aujourd'hui, on voudrait disposer de vaccins.
So now we would like them to be less heat sensitive and to have more flexibility with the cold chain. Just over a year ago, MSF and Epicent conducted an efficacy study on the tetanus vaccine in Chad. The study showed that a vaccine could be stored for 30 days at under 40 degrees and will still be effective.
MSF is also exploring new ways of associating immunization with other preventive measures.
Up until now, in many countries, vaccination was proposed separately. Families would come with their child to see the vaccinator. This year in Chad, we chose to associate immunization with seasonal malaria prevention. So we didn't just target children in the 0 to 11 month age range, but included older children too. The fact that we associated vaccination enabled us to vaccinate over 50% of children aged 0 to 11 months and provide immunization coverage for 20 to 30% of children who hadn't been able to complete their vaccinations before the age of 1 year.
Back to Ethiopia and the children from South Sudan. So now they're protected against cholera, but there are other threats to their health. Several months later, MSF decided to protect them against respiratory infections. These efforts demonstrate MSF's determination to increase the number of vaccines it can provide during emergency operations. As in Ethiopia, thousands of Ugandan children were given the PCV vaccination in 2014 to reduce the risk of pneumonia. But campaigns like these are all too rare, because the cost of the pneumococcal vaccine is far too high, $21 for 3 doses, and that's the best-case scenario.
It is estimated that 450,000 of the world's population suffer from multi-resistant tuberculosis. But in 2013, less than 100,000 received treatment. This type of tuberculosis is called multi-resistant because it's resistant to the two main antibiotics commonly used to treat it. Multi-resistance is a real nightmare for patients and a headache for their medical teams, as treatment is long, 2 years. Complex, toxic. It's not even effective, as only half of patients make a full recovery. Varden is 60. The multi-resistant tuberculosis he suffers from was first diagnosed 8 years ago, and he has to take a huge amount of drugs every day.
I've been taking the drugs for almost 7 years. I know them off by heart, and I know each of their side effects and what they do to me. In the past 7 years, I've had 8 months at home with my family. I've been in hospital for the rest of the time, 6.5 years.
Bedaquiline and delaminid are two new tuberculosis drugs and the first real hope for these patients. Currently in development, these two drugs are often not registered in the worst affected countries. Consequently, less than 1,000 patients around the world benefit from them. The reason for this underutilization is that little is known about these drugs, especially their side effects and how they interact with other treatments.
These new molecules are a huge hope for patients with TB, but they're only half the battle. In order to comply with international recommendations, they must be taken in addition to current multi-resistant tuberculosis treatments.
To speed up the process, MSF decided to launch an extensive project in partnership with two organizations playing a key role in combating tuberculosis: the US Partners in Health and the Pakistani aid organization Interactive Research and Development. The project, funded to the tune of $60 million by UNITAID, was launched in April 2015. Its aim is to facilitate access to the two molecules and to define a precise treatment based on the two drugs.
Tuberculosis is unusual in that it is treated using a combination of drugs, what we call a therapeutic regimen, an association of different drugs. But these two new molecules offer us the opportunity to identify and define new therapeutic regimens or new combinations of drugs to give us more effective, shorter, and better tolerated treatments.
So the project calls for a clinical trial. The challenge is to determine the combination of old and new drugs to arrive at a treatment that is as short, easy to take, and with as few side effects as possible. Implemented in 16 countries, the project will provide 3,200 patients access to these promising new drugs.
MSF teams in the field encounter antibiotic resistance more and more often. For example, in Haiti, some patients being treated for burns carry germs that don't respond to the most commonly used antibiotics, which results in long and costly treatments, or at worst, treatment failure. Staff at the MSF hospital in Jordanian capital Amman, who treat casualties from Iraq, Syria and Yemen, are all too aware of the problem. Doctors here have been confronting the issue of antibiotic resistance that affects half of all patients since the hospital opened 8 years ago.
What we are seeing now in our surgical work is that more and more antibiotics are needed and many patients cannot be treated with the normal range of antibiotics. In fact, with the rising level of antibiotic resistance around the world, we are almost now running out of options in most of the places that we are working.
This little boy has had surgery, and like him, patients are tested to identify the bacteria that caused their infections and then given the appropriate treatment.
The choice of antibiotics is often very limited because the germs are multi-resistant, so we have to use the last resort antibiotics that are specifically for combating these germs. Treatment is long, 6 weeks of intravenous antibiotics and then at least 4 weeks of oral treatment. Antibiotic therapy is extremely pricey. It now represents 25% of the hospital's budget.
The teams often see patients with infected bones as they have little defense against this type of bacterial aggression. The germ weakens the bones, and without effective treatment, amputation is the only option. In September 2014, MSF organized a conference in Amman, attended by some 80 healthcare specialists, who shared their experiences on treating antibiotic resistance in the Middle East. The participants reached agreement on a number of points to combat this scourge. Without waiting for the conclusions of the conference, MSF defined a strategy for the years ahead to fight antibiotic resistance.
Dans un premier temps, c'est de pouvoir améliorer la prescription des antibiotiques.
For starters, we need to be able to improve antibiotic prescriptions in hospitals and then extend that to outpatient services too. We also need to develop and make available bacteriology laboratories in our programs that need them. And lastly, to improve hospital hygiene at our facilities.
A new bacteriology laboratory was set up at MSF's referral center in Koutiala in Mali at the beginning of 2014. The analysis it produces provide a better understanding of the nature of patients' infections, so we can prescribe the appropriate antibiotic therapy. Médecins Sans Frontières has developed a portable and standalone mini-lab to perform tests in centers that have no laboratory.
The mini lab is a miniature laboratory that performs cheaper bacteriological analyses. This means that hospitals that need such analyses will have access at a cost of under 10 euros.
MSF wants to assign specialist personnel to increase infection control measures in all its programs. It's only by implementing more adapted prescriptions, routine monitoring of infections, information sharing, and enhancing capacity for analyses that MSF will be able to better respond to cases of antibiotic resistance in its programs.